Hi there, everybody. My name is Lauren Spring, and I'm an art educator with the Art Gallery of Ontario. And we have a very special virtual school program session for you this morning because I'm joined by one of my colleagues. I'm here today with Marilyn Nazar, who is an archivist at the AGO. And we are here today to talk about institutional archives, which is a very exciting topic. I wonder, Marilyn, I'll just maybe do a bit of a land acknowledgement and then we'll launch into who you are and what you do and all of that. Does that sound good?
Yep, sounds great.
Perfect. So I do want to thank the AGO community for making these virtual school programs possible, especially the Michael Young Family Foundation. Thank you. Here is our beautiful institution, which you're going to get a really neat sort of behind the scenes glimpse into some of the things that go on here today. And I also just want to take a moment to acknowledge that the land the AGO is on is Mississauga-Anishinaabe territory, Mississauga. It is also governed by a treaty between the Mississauga of the Credit and the Canadian government. Toronto is Mississauga-Anishinaabe territory. It has also been occupied by other Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat Confederacies. All right, so as we said today, our focus, this session is for grade 9 to 12, but whoever you are, if you're here, you're welcome to continue along with us. We're here, talking about library and archives, and especially institutional archives within the AGO. So Marilyn, if you wouldn't mind maybe at first, before we launch into the slides and some of the unique themes of our presentation today, just telling us kind of what does an archivist do at the AGO? Why is it important?
Okay. Well, so as you said, I handle the institutional records of the Art Gallery of Ontario. So that includes photographs, recording of artist talks, interviews, lectures, and panel discussions that have taken place at the AGO, records of all of our exhibitions. We have architectural plans of all of our building reiterations. We have correspondence with artists, curators, people who lend artworks to our exhibitions. And we also document all the meetings minutes where most of the important decisions about our institution are made and the future direction of our institution are made. So that's basically what I handle. I organize those things. I preserve them for prosperity, I help to preserve them, catalog them, and I also help them to make them available to the researchers who want to access them. That can be people who are working within the institution, educational staff and curators, but it can also be people outside, art historians. I've had artists work with the archives, other curators from around the globe who actually access our historical records. And they can do that for a variety of reasons. So it's actually an important way to document our history. It also in part documents the history, the exhibition and collection history of a lot of the artists that we engage with.
Mm. Yeah, so, hearing kind of the different things that are being archived within the institution, my mind is already sort of whirling about all of the reasons why, someone might want to access this, tomorrow or 20 years from now. And so I think we'll delve into some of the slides here because some of the, essentially the pieces that we've selected to discuss today are about protests and times, throughout our history where maybe the AGO was not seen in the most positive light. There were people within the city who were saying, hey, what you're doing is wrong. And, I think it's vital to point out too, we're not just kind of keeping things that make the AGO look great and this kind of shiny image throughout history where it's actually about conflict and times that the institution has, engaged in conversations with the broader community about specific issues and had to do some self-examination and in many cases has made some changes as a result. So I can see already why, documenting when and how these things happened show us the direction that we've taken and I think we can really easily relate to some of the things happening in kind of social justice movements today too. So why don't we rewind in time? Let's go back to like the 60s and 70s and you can tell us a bit what's going on here.
Okay, so many people might be aware that the 60s and 70s were a time of worldwide protest movements, a lot of anti-racism movements, women's rights, environmental rights, and specifically in Canada, protests to protect Canadian culture and identity from being overshadowed by a lot of American and British European influences. So not surprising, the AGO, as a major institution in the country, had its share of protests during this time. And the first one being a very sort of humorously done, as you can see by the signs, lots of puns and playing on words, protest by Central Tech High School students about the purchase of Klaus Oldenburg's Floor Burger, which we'll see in a moment. It's a really popular piece now, but at the time, yeah, that's it there. At the time, pardon me?
Yeah, just to show folks, this is the piece that they were all protesting about when the AGO purchased this one.
Yeah. So not surprised, so the students just didn't think this work, which is an example of pop art, and you can correct me there, an art movement popular at the time, they didn't think it constituted real art and didn't believe it was the work the AGO should be collecting or exhibiting. Now, to understand, Central Tech was then and still is, I think, a high school that focuses a lot on the arts and has a lot of art related programming. And you can see just how creative they are in their signage and the beautiful photograph with the stance of this one woman, particularly in front. And then of course they built the ketchup bottle, you know, they built that out of plywood and carried it, hauled it over to the AGO.
And I think, yeah, and it's interesting, were they taken seriously, Marilyn? I know, you know, they weren't the only ones in the public saying, why is the AGO spending money on this funky, like, floor burger? Did the AGO take them seriously?
I think the AGO had some fun with it. And I think, so yes and no. You know, the AGO always takes it seriously when people don't like things and they listen. But it was very tongue in cheek. And I think the AGO felt that this was a really important exhibition that this piece was part of and an important part of our collection. So I think overall, the newspapers had a lot of fun with the visual puns and humor, but they were all equally critical of the protesters and the purchase of the floor burger. So the media called the protest a gag, but also referred to the purchase of the floor burger as a lemon in an unwise purchase. So you sort of had a bit of both, right?
Yeah, and we have a great comment from a student here saying how it's funny how they protested this work, but it still inspired their own creativity and how they engaged in their protest. And I think that's one of the beautiful things that's documented here, right? It wasn't just, you know, a haphazard, like, okay, let's go protest in front. Like, clearly the students put a lot of thought and creativity into these. They're really quite funny, these signs here. Don't burger our art gallery. We're mustard here because we don't relish this. Like there was a lot of fun with these puns too.
And it's kind of funny because, they ended up sort of doing exactly what Klaus Oldenburg is doing with this piece, which is sort of satirizing a certain part of society. You know, Klaus Oldenburg, this was originally called the Giant Hamburger and was part of a trio of sculptures with giant ice cream that was exhibited in Los Angeles at around the same time. And Giant Slice of Cake was another piece that was part of this trilogy. And the works, Oldenburg was providing a satirical commentary on the rise of consumer culture within our society. And in a sense, that's what the protesters were playing. They were satirizing someone who's already satirizing the same thing in a way. So that was kind of interesting, yeah.
Absolutely, and I think, you know, it's interesting too, because Oldenburg was doing, you know, as a member of this kind of pop artist group coming out of the United States, just like Marilyn's saying, yeah, he was satirizing popular culture, essentially. And so someone's asking, like, why had the AGO decided to buy this piece? It was considered, like, quite revolutionary at the time. One of the things about it is that it's both a painting and a sculpture. This is a really cool piece because it's actually made out of canvas that Oldenburg painted, and then his wife actually, who was also an artist, stitched it together. So when you're walking around it, you're like, okay, it's three-dimensional, it's a sculpture, but it's not made of bronze or wood or marble. You know, it's actually made out of canvas. So in this, during this time period, artists were really playing with this question, like, what is art? And then, like Marilyn saying too, looking at popular culture and saying, oh, in galleries, we consider things kind of high art. Whereas what if we kind of incorporate pop culture and what the masses sort of consume and have access to and put that in this institutional setting? So there's a lot of kind of class arguments involved in the pop movement in general. And so the AGO would have decided to purchase it because it was, you know, an up and coming, very contemporary thing. And this kind of hot debate in the art world is, how do we do art differently? How do we define art? I think that's key. And Marilyn, can you tell us how much the AGO paid for this? Why, what would have been considered so expensive back in 67?
They actually paid $2,000 for it, which, in, if I looked up in today's terms, would have been less than $16,000, which is not a lot for a piece of work of this caliber. Even at the time, it was quite, you know, he was quite a famous New York artist. So $2,000, yeah.
Yeah, so not, I would argue that it's, I mean, the money was probably came into play, but it was probably more what it was and how this was upsetting certain definitions of art or what belonged in a high art institution like this that really caused such a ruckus.
Yeah, yeah. And Klaus Oldenburg did know about the protest, right?
Yeah.
And he just said, his only criticism was that they didn't make the ketchup bottle, which they tried to donate to the AGO, but we turned it down. They didn't make the ketchup bottle out of something softer than plywood, adding that his sculptures are soft and emphasize a sense of touch. So it's made out of foam or rubber underneath the canvas. Yeah. That was his criticism.
Hey guys, if you're going to critique this and make your own, like, at least have it uniform with the soft sculpture theme here. I could imagine he probably would have been pretty entertained too, and it gave his work a lot of press at the same time, right? It kind of helped his class. Someone is asking why the pickle or cucumber is not in the burger. I'd say there are kind of two reasons for this. One is probably compositional. If it were inside, we wouldn't actually see the green, and you know, it sort of lightens up what is by most accounts kind of a pretty drab looking unappetizing burger. He wanted that too, right? He was critiquing sort of fast food consumerism, and so he wanted it to look kind of unappetizing. But also during the 60s and 70s, if you were to go to a diner, oftentimes the pickle would actually come at the top, like there'd be a little toothpick sort of holding it at the top. So I think that's part of the reason too. All right, let's move on to the next protest. This one's about Canadian identity, a theme that continues today.
Yep.
Can you tell us about what's happening here?
Yeah, so in 1972, a group of artists calling themselves the Committee to Strengthen Canadian Culture tied themselves together in the gallery to protest the hiring of an American curator, Richard Wantonmaker, as chief curator. So he was the second American curator hired. The first one was Mario Amayo, who was chief curator 1969 to 1972. And there were concerns at the time that the AGO was already favored exhibition and collections of artworks by American and European British artists at the expense of many contemporary Canadian artists. And it was believed that this would worsen with the hiring of another American to oversee the collections program. Mm. So they tied themselves.
How long did this protest last, Marilyn?
It was about a 3-hour protest, so not a very long one. And it wasn't very effective. So the media largely criticized the protesters, referring to them as a hate group in one headline and a second-rate artist. But you know, Wattenmaker served as chief curator until 1978, when he was replaced by Roald Nasgard, a Canadian who was already a curator on staff, so a Canadian that had been promoted up. So I think, you know, the AGO, this is an example of the AGO kind of listening and thinking, okay, we've got to pay attention to what these artists are saying. And I think out of that, you know, they started to develop the J.S. MacLean Center out of that as well.
Yeah, and we know in recent years too, the J.S. McLean Center has gone through a number of transitions, like, and I think it's important to note, so this is a critique of, yeah, an American curator being hired, but certainly, you know, the AGO has been reconciling with a lot of big questions about Canadian identity and who is represented in our Canadian galleries and in what ways, and how can we do this more effectively? So these are, you know, conversations that really continue to this day. And now it's the McLean Center of Canadian and Indigenous Art. And over the past couple of years, we, you know, have ensured that we have one in Nanaimo now, this phenomenal Indigenous, she's our curator of Indigenous art, and she works alongside our curator of Canadian art. And so these works are really in conversation, but I think, yeah, even, you know, this wasn't that long ago, in just a couple of decades, and Canadian identity and the artists that we might see represented here meant something very different than it would today. And I think, you know, similar protests taking place today would talk more about representation and how we define who's Canadian and you know, the AGO is a public institution. And so which, you know, all members of the public should find themselves represented on our walls. And we know that that's not always the case. And so can you identify any of the artists here who were taking part?
And I don't know if I can point. Yes, I can. I don't know if people can see that I'm pointing, but this is Michael Snow, Joyce Wieland. And I'm not sure. I think that might, and I might get this wrong, John Boyle. But also, you know, there were quite a few well-known artists as part of this. So John Boyle sat on the board in the later 1970s. He sat on the AGO's board of directors, board of trustees, and Joyce Wieland, who I pointed to, also was sitting on the board of trustees around the same time in 1972. And of course, you know, Joyce Wieland had major exhibitions at the AGO and the National Gallery of Canada. And Michael Snow, of course, was in our collection already and had exhibitions at the AGO and was showing internationally at the time. So these were fairly well-known artists. Michelle Lambeth was also part of this, group and was a really good documentary or street photographer.
Interesting. Yeah, and I think it's so interesting too, because yeah, these folks, we see kind of tying themselves up here, getting some media attention for this protest. We're quite well established. And so, you know, I think when we talk about these debates too, about who's being represented and in what ways, it's not necessarily, you know, people who are sitting on boards who are the ones who are not represented in this day and age. And I don't know if any students who are tuning in right now might want to speak to that. Perhaps you've had experience, you know, walking through the halls and the galleries in the AGO and not feeling represented, or perhaps you've been there in recent years and have seen some of these changes and think, oh yeah, wait, this is so interesting that they're putting this, you know, work from 1912 in conversation with one, you know, from 2008, and what do these works actually say to each other? I think, yeah, not only in terms of the artists that we're displaying on our walls and purchasing works from, but also how we situate them in conversation with history about Canadian identity. Is really quite, you know, there's a lot of thought that's being put into that now, and certainly when I'm there in the space with members of the public, there's new kinds of learning that are happening as a result. All right, we have a few more. So,
This is two slides, two images from the Committee to Strengthen Canadian Culture and Regrouped to protest the opening of our first gallery expansion in 50 years called Stage One in 1974. And the protesters, the gallery expansion featured the opening of the Henry Moore Sculpture Center, which was the largest square footage of new gallery space dedicated to one British artist, Henry Moore. And the protesters thought, the Committee to Strengthen Canadian Culture thought, instead of dedicating such a large gallery to one British artist, the AGO should rename the space the Tom Thompson Gallery and exhibit Canadian art and artists instead of one British artist. But you can see from the protest images that it was about way more than just showing Canadian art. It was really about what you've been talking about, Lauren, about what constitutes Canadian identity. Who does that represent? So you can see a lot of the signs saying art is for rich people, white people, some people, them people. And then the other sign here, so we have the Scottish pipe band that was hired for the opening celebrations. So again, really, really grounding the history of the gallery in sort of a white colonialist, British-based background. But we have this person, Canadian art, and excuse the terminology, it's out of date, Black, Eskimo, Indian, that would be, of course, Indigenous now, true or false. But again, speaking to how we have excluded certain groups within Canadian culture that are not part of the gallery, that are not represented. What's interesting about this protest is the actual protesters, the Committee to Strengthen Canadian Culture, the AGO, the media, Henry Moore, never talked about that kind of inclusivity or exclusivity of, you know, Black, Indigenous, people of color, women, artists. They only spoke about Canadian identity. They didn't really drill down into that and what that meant. But the protest photographs tell a very different story, which I think is very telling and very relevant today.
It's so interesting. And even your note about how language has changed, right? Like certainly today they would be referred to as Inuit and Indigenous people, and how even, you know, it shows, and I think that's part of the reason these archives are so important. It shows these little steps towards progress and towards, you know, how people want to be represented, and names that are more or less offensive, and how kind of we take these steps throughout history. We, you know, there's been an interesting kind of renaming of an Indian, the Emily Carr painting that used to be called Indian Church. And recently, you know, because in conversation with members of the public, we've changed the name and have done a really interesting kind of label copy write up about why that is. And so it's so neat to see not only how the collection evolves, but also, yeah, how language evolves with us, and in large part as a result of protests like this and kind of public action in these ways.
It also shows how long, you know, how quickly in some ways an institution can respond and change, and how long it can take for change to happen. So it speaks to both things, because we're still really undergoing, and particularly in the last 5 years, a real change to examine, you know, how we break down our colonialist roots, how we do that, how we become a really more inclusive organization. And that's been quite a protest, but it really started here. You know, so if you think about that 50 years of rethinking our own history, it's really been quite a long process.
Yeah. And it's huge too, right? There's kind of small micro level actions, but then the bigger, like, wait a second, even the idea of art galleries comes from a very Eurocentric, like, you know, Western art historical tradition of separating art from everyday life. Not all cultures in the world do that. And so, you know, when you start to kind of poke the beast, all these other questions emerge too.
Absolutely. And the whole notion of high art versus pop art, which we were just, you know, talking about in the earlier piece. So you can see how all of these protests become connected and start to shape and form our history. Yeah.
Absolutely. So we have another, this is a really fascinating story. Can you tell us a bit about what's happening here in Maryland?
Okay, so in 1976, Roald Nasgard, in conjunction, in the Art Gallery of Ontario, in conjunction with the Art Gallery of Edmonton, co-curated an exhibition of 40 some odd artists called Changing Visions, the Canadian Landscape, which was about reinterpretations of the Canadian landscape. Again, that Canadian identity coming in, re-envisioned by contemporary artists, mostly contemporary artists. And so it toured across Canada and it actually into the United States to 9 different museums. But the exhibition was, the problem came in because the exhibition was co-sponsored by the Reed Paper Company, which owned and operated the Dryden Paper Company between 1960 and 1979. And the Dryden Paper Company was the company responsible for dumping 10 tons of mercury between 1962 and 71 in the Wabagoon River system. So this dumping of mercury has caused severe long-term generational health concerns for the First Nations of Grassy Narrows. Yes, and someone's just saying, I see, is that near Grassy Narrows? Yes, that's exactly what we're talking about. And they lived about 100 kilometers away from this, and they relied on those waters for food and the fish in those waters for food and livelihood. The Reed Paper Company is also known for clear-cutting logging interests in Canada. So probably not the right company to sponsor an exhibition about landscape in Canada. Definitely not a good choice. And so there was a protest at the opening, and this is one of the photographs from the opening protest.
And it's so fascinating too, right? Because I mean, to this day, the AGO, when we have big exhibitions, they always have corporate sponsors. We could not survive without this sponsorship. And so we're really reliant on that and grateful for that in many cases. But it's true that, you know, sometimes you think, okay, well, this exhibition is so important because it's highlighting this and this issue and for public education in these ways. But then, yeah, if the ethics of a particular company or organization don't really align or, you know, blatantly contrast with what's being shown, there's definitely people in the public who are doing their research about that and calling that out.
Now, at the time, it was really denied in the media and by the Ontario government. But, you know, as we know, this is still very much in the news today. Grassy Narrows, the Ashipisiwagong people, First Nations, and it's still very much in the news. And of course, so is just water issues, water rights, clean access to clean water for a lot of Indigenous communities. So it's still very, very relevant today.
Yeah. And did you
So this is a piece by Jack Chambers, who's one of the artists who showed. Jack Chambers, Greg Curnow, Michael Snow, Joyce Wheeland, Jack Buss, Patterson Ewan, Gershon Iskowitz, a lot of very well-known Canadian artists, but just to note, there were no Indigenous or Inuit artists in this show.
And did some of the artists to protest the sponsorship?
Some of them did, not all of them, which is interesting. No one actually, I, as far as I can tell from the records, no artists pulled their work from the show. But Jack Chambers did write to Roald Nascar, curator of the exhibition, saying, and I quote, "I'm insulted and horrified by the kind of corporate hypocrisy that allows Reed to take credit for an art exhibition glorifying Canadian landscape when in fact Reed and others like them are directly responsible for destroying it. He asked that Reed Paper Company be dropped as a sponsor and his work be removed from the end." Jack Chambers' work be removed from the exhibition. Just to note, neither happened, but a copy of his letter to Roald Nascar that I just quoted from was posted beside his work at every gallery on tour.
Interesting. So yeah, and it's complicated for an artist too, right? Because they'd be in this AGO show, it could be a big break and huge publicity. And we know often artists are not, you know, they need this kind of exposure and they're often not the most wealthy amongst us. And so then, yeah, to kind of stand up for what they believe in, how do you negotiate that? So lots, you've brought up so many interesting things, Marilyn. I think we're actually pretty much out of time already.
Okay.
Yeah, it goes by so fast. But I wanted to give you a big thank you, Marilyn, and as well to the students. Thanks for your great questions and for being here today. We hope this sparked some ideas and maybe a little bit more knowledge about AGO history and what we can continue to take issue with and question today too. So thanks so much, everyone.
This was great. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
We'll see you next time.